Well, good morning and welcome to our 2014 VF Outlet planning session. I'd like to first let you know that we are going to be videotaping this morning's presentation so that the stores can receive a copy of it tomorrow in the mail, and they'll be able to view and have the same opportunity that you're seeing today so we can get everybody in the organization aligned around our same goals and priorities for the year. I'd also like to thank Stephanie for all the hard work of pulling this event together. It always seems easy when things go flawlessly, and when they don't, you realize how much work went into it, or should have went into it. So far, Stephanie, job well done. Thank you very much. So I'm going to start off today's presentation really reflecting a little bit about last year and all the many milestones that we accomplished. And I think we have to really be reflective and be excited about what all happened, because that's the springboard that we're using for 2015 to continue to grow and build our business. And it's a great place to start. I think all of you would have to agree that the energy and the enthusiasm and the opportunity that the integration with Jeanswear has provided has been really exciting. I know all of my partners at Jeanswear feel the same way. And for all the merchant teams that interact with the Jeanswear teams, I know it's been very, very exciting to be able to have partners who are much more engaged and much more willing to be partners in growing our business. And that's been really exciting. We also initiated our innovation platform process last year. It started with the store, the Sales and Leadership Summit, that we introduced the idea of innovation and the platform or processes that go into an innovative idea. All of you helped to identify the 13 big problems that we needed to organize and to deal with. We've made great headway in many of those. You'll see a lot of those as continuations of ideas that we started at the management and continuing to this year's initiatives as well. We're going to push that process a little bit further down into the organization. The stores are going to adopt an innovation platform where they're going to document their ideas, identify great ideas, and then act and work on solutions to bring them to light. And the corporate office is going to, through the departments, are going to introduce the same process where we formalize the way we identify ideas to generate value. And keep in mind, the definition at VF of innovation is anything new that creates value. And that's a really important phrase. As you start to unlock today's presentation, you're going to understand how that word really becomes important to us as a team, and it fits into so many other things that we're doing. We're going to define our brand identity and culture, and I'm going to let Michaela kind of take the lead on that. We'll chime back in a little bit later, but you'll understand more about what that means as we work through today's presentation. Everyone will leave here today with a thorough understanding of what VF Outlet is and what are the key actions that we're going to do to make sure that we are true to that mission and to that brand statement. We also built enormous sales momentum. In 2014, you'll remember back in Q1, we finished the quarter down about 4%. Maybe it was 3.5-4%. In Q2, we were down just a smidge, like 0.5% or 0.8%, something like that. In Q3, we posted positive numbers, so now we were up like 1%. And in Q4, we ended up plus 2.1 or 2.2%. And the total year was a 0.1% comp increase, right? And we all celebrated at the end of the year, which is a wonderful thing to do to celebrate something meaningful, right? We had a pizza party, but everybody knew what we had that pizza party for. We accomplished a 2014 sales comp compared to prior year, right? Which is what every business strives for, growing year over year. And for all of you involved in this business in any place, that has got to be your primary focus. And then in recognition and reward for that, we are pleased to announce this morning that everyone in the organization will receive a 2.4% incentive bonus against your salary for all of last year's earnings based on our performance and VF corporate performance.
Yay!
That incentive bonus, it will be paid to all salaried and exception hourly employees on March the 6th. For all hourly paid employees, it will be paid on March the 13th. All right, so for those of you who are new to the organization, that bonus is paid, as I said, is 2.4% of your year-to-date earnings on 2014's W-2. All right, so that's how the company rewards it to every single employee, regardless of full-time or part-time status. It's a percent of your earnings, so it's fair and equitable to everyone involved. So big, big celebration, great accomplishment.
Wow. All right, so I'll take it from there. Thank you, Rick. Good morning, everybody. So today we're going to be talking about brand positioning statements, mission, vision, core values. So I want to start with the mission, which is a crucial element of the whole process. As we know, every brand, every successful brand, and every organization needs a mission statement in order to succeed. And the clearer is the mission, the more successful the brand will be. The more actionable the mission, right, the higher the chance of success in implementing it. So, the mission allows us to really get to the core of who we are as a brand, what we stand for as an organization. So it's a long, long process that really means for us to go through the process of really understanding who we are as a company. And we've done that all last year. We spent all 2014 really trying to get to the core and really the true essence of VF Outlet is as a brand, and really what we stand for is, and as an organization. And the result of that work was really the definition of our brand positioning statement, our mission statement, our vision, our brand vision, and obviously our core values, which we'll go through it. The biggest challenge that really came out of the focus groups that we did late in 2013 was really our inability to communicate clearly who we are. And it came through loud and clear through our focus groups that we did. If we ask every single one of us, we probably have an idea. We could probably reiterate it, but it wouldn't be in a consistent voice. And that's because we never took the opportunity to go through the entire process and really analyze it and really identify, like, what has made us successful this year? What's at the core of our existing as a brand, as an organization? What's made us stand out compared to the competition? Why, for the last 40 years, people have been coming back to us day in and day out, and made us, the brand that we are, the company that we are today. So that was the essence of that study that we did last year, and we came out with a really concise mission statement, a really clear brand positioning, and a really clear brand vision, and most importantly, a set of core values that we can all abide by. It's gonna give us the focus. It's gonna give us just the opportunity to communicate in unison with the message and with the really with the core message of who we are as a company. It is a process that we vetted really, really extensively. We shared it with our group in several meetings, and we all felt really, really good about it, that it was really on point and it really represented who we are as a company. But then also we took the opportunity to share it at the summit meeting that we did last year, and it was part of one of the innovation groups. So I had about 7 to 8 store managers from different districts, from different walks of life, read it, analyze it, and they all came back with a really unison feedback in that it was right on point. So we feel really, really good about sharing it now, making it public, and really giving us the opportunity to kind of embrace it and really running with it. So now before we reveal what the mission is, the mission statement is, let's talk about what is a mission statement, right? It's really what defines us as a brand and as an organization. It's the main reason why we come to work every morning and do what it is that we do, right? It allows us to be focused, and most importantly, it allows us all to speak with the same voice and the same message. So, what is our mission? Every single day, delivering the best value to our customer. That's it. It's very simple, yet it's very, very powerful. Because it really speaks to the possibility, right? And when we talk about best value, we're not just talking about price. It's really value interpreted in all its myriad interpretation. And it can be something as simple. Obviously, price is a huge, huge part of that. The customers, vote on that every day when they come to our store. But it's also, you know, how else can we deliver value to our customer? Is it perhaps by maybe speeding up the FIFO process in the back of the store, so to bring the goods onto the floor faster, so the customer can get access faster? Is it, you know, when you guys go to the marketplace, perhaps, you know, negotiate a better deal with the vendor? Is it us marketing when we, you know, negotiate, you know, prices for resources, whether it's for paper or whatever, so we get a better discount, so that we can pass it on to the customer? Is it maybe the store line people, you know, being extra kind to the customer? So what I'm trying to get at is let us be open minded about the concept of value and how we deliver value to our customer and also to our team members. And that's where also innovation comes to play as well, because it's one of the same thing, right? The more creative, the more effective we get at delivering value, the more innovative we are being day in and day out. So so every single day, delivering the best value to our customers. So that's going to be our mission. It's always been there. We just never took the time to really officialize it, to iterate it. But now we're saying that this is what's going to drive us. This is what's going to motivate us. This is what's going to bring us to work every morning and focus on. And if we can become so focused on it, if all of us embrace it, I have no doubt that we can really write the book and really become the expert on generating value. And the customers are going to notice that, and they're going to pay attention to that, and they're going to respond to it by either continue patronizing us more often, more frequently, but also referring us to their network of friends.
Well, I'd say the best part about the whole value proposition and the whole mission statement and the whole brand promise is that it is authentic to who we are. You know, we're not changing anything. We're not asking you to do anything differently than you've done in the past. You're just going to be more focused. You'll be able to articulate it more clearly. But it is so true to who we are and what we do and how our customers perceive us, right? That is, it's authentic, right? It's, this is as genuine and authentic as you can be. The words we chose to articulate our brand promise are words that represented exactly what we are, right? There's no twist of words. There's no Washington spin on this. You know, this is just true, authentic words that represent who we are and help everyone in the organization and our customers to understand that position and to be true to it, right? So it's really guiding principles rather than it is a new direction.
Exactly. So what is our mission?
Every single day, delivering the best value to our customers.
All right, that was great.
I think we can do better, Miguel.
I didn't hear, right? What's our mission?
Every single day, delivering the best value to our customers.
All right.
That's pretty good. I think we deserve applause.
Now it's official. And I'm going to pass on to Deborah. She'll talk to us about our vision.
And our vision is to make VF Outlet the favorite destination for the millions of moms and families on a budget by offering the best values and assortment on great quality national brands. And again, it is what we already do. It's just putting it into words. And I think that's absolutely every day what we do.
Yep.
Our values. So as I was thinking about how I wanted to present our values, two words came into mind, action and behavior. And our success is determined on each one of our actions and behaviors. I mean, the words and descriptions that you're about to see in our values really talk about who we are, and they help guide our actions and behaviors. These values are the roadmap to supporting our vision and our mission. Our values are commitment. Every single day, we will be unwaveringly committed to the principle of creating value for our customer. Respect. We will treat every single customer and fellow team member with the utmost respect and dignity. Innovation. We will work tirelessly on improving how we deliver on our mission. Focus. Focus on the customer and team members' needs, and all else will fall into place. Empowerment. Every single employee should feel empowered to focus on the customer and deliver value to him or her. Integrity. We will conduct ourselves with integrity and honesty in our daily interactions with customers and fellow team members, first and foremost, and creating wealth through profit and growth. Crucial to remember that we are a for-profit organization and that we take that responsibility to our shareholders very seriously. Those are our values.
Pretty true. Pretty true to who we are, right? I think that when you read through those words, they really do resonate with what VF Outlet has been and is. But it really provides clarity and descriptive words to help to ensure that as new people become assimilated to the organization, they can do it quicker, and that we are always minded and guided by key words that guide us. So in 2015, we sort of need to now have some clearly stated objectives that help us get to where we want to be at the end of the year, right? And this is the brand objective. So at the highest level, these are the things that we're working on. So first, we have to achieve our financial targets. And I think that's true every year. You know, we said that in our values that we are a for-profit organization. And therefore, you have to have numbers that guide your decision-making and that give you a target to work towards. It's the goal line. And we all know that it's important to get to that. So we'll share the plan with you as our targets get finalized. We're really close. But as the MICP targets get finalized, the plans get finalized, you hear it. Matt will talk you through the actual plan that's in place for us right now. And that's how we're going to work, and those are the numbers we'll work towards. The next is executing against our strategic initiatives. So I told you that we are really involved in innovation, and this really is the innovation platform that we're using to launch these big ideas. So within the strategic initiatives, there are five big ideas that we are working hard on. First is commercializing our brand position. So Michaela talked an awful lot about it. Commercializing the brand position, to me, is making it so it's actionable. Turning the ideas and thoughts of those words into actions that people can understand, that you can understand, that our customers can embrace, and that they will act on. So by telling customers about these values, they will embrace them and want to become part of our customer base and grow the business. Create Lee and Wrangler brand shops. Everyone, I think, in the organization, from the conversations we had during our monthly touch base meetings, understands the work that the merchants are doing to truly transform our business into becoming more brand-centric. Lee and Wrangler are the key jeanswear brands. They are VF Outlet's key national brands. So taking the idea and the strategy that we currently merchandise items in our store by category, We merchandise our pants together, we merchandise our tops together, we merchandise our accessories together. We're going to change that in fall of 2015. We're going to change it a lot and drastically on the female side of the business, and we're going to introduce smaller changes to the male side of the business, all right? And it's going to be a lot of work. You know, we're going to start to merchandise by brand. So you're going to walk in your store and you're going to see the Lee female shop inside the store is the first thing you see on the denim pad. It will be merchandised Lee branded tops and Lee branded bottoms together on the same fixture, helping customers to understand how to build outfits and that the brand stands for more than just bottoms. It's now an outfit. We're carrying that strategy over into making the Riders brand shop bigger, you know, Riders by Lee. We have last year, I think Deanna and the female team sort of did a pilot with merchandising Riders together like that, and we saw an enormous success. You know, we're going to continue to build on that idea. They're making the product assortment bigger, and we're going to add additional fixtures and collateral to these shops to help them stand out in the store. Probably the biggest, I think it's the biggest launch and the biggest introduction we're going to do next year is going to be in introducing Wrangler to the female side of the business. Wrangler will have both bottoms and tops introduced into our store in the female side of the store, and they'll be merchandised together as a shop. That is just the start of what is yet to come as we start to make Wrangler a bigger female brand. But we're going to launch it first at VF Outlet. On the male side of the business, we will have a brand shop. We're going to bring back Lee Dungarees. It'll be positioned towards a slightly younger side of our consumer base, and that'll be merchandised together as tops and bottoms as Lee Dungarees. So big, big things to come in that process. And again, everybody in the organization, you'll see as they present their objectives, every department has something to do with that initiative because it's that big. Leverage price optimization. We've experimented with it. Many of you involved in it. Certainly, we've had a lot of stores out there doing reticketing and restickering to try and understand if price endings and price points can influence the way customers buy and the gross margin dollars that we can generate on those. We're learning a lot about it. We're about to go into phase two of that test. The first test, we tested too small of categories. We weren't able to get an absolute read on it. So we're going to add and go back to additional larger classifications or categories of merchandise so we can see bigger volume movement and ensure that we understand what's happening not only at the category level but at the price point level within that category so we can get smarter about how we price our merchandise. Real estate strategy. You're seeing a lot of these things come through as you read this, as you read it up there, a small store format. That's something that we will talk more about as the year develops, but we are going to go back and spend more time on the formats that we have piloted in Myrtle Beach 2 and in El Paso. Those stores are 15,000 square feet, and we think that that still is the long-term future of VF Outlet, is to continue to operate smaller and more productive store formats. So we're going to look for real estate around Redding, so that we can have like a day trip, so it's close enough that we can get to the store within a day and get back all in the same work day and really understand the product, the assortment, the placement of product, and the productivity of each category of merchandise within the store, and try to figure out how to make even a bigger, stronger, more brand-centric store. So if we build out around these brand launches we're doing of Lee and Wrangler, it'll make the other merchandise categories proportionate, but yet probably a little smaller in the store. Figuring out what that perfect mix is of product in a smaller store to get maximum sales per square foot. So that's one of the things we're working on later this year. The Wrangler full price store, it is official. We are going to open a Wrangler full price store. The Wrangler as a brand launched a store in Denver, Colorado 5 years ago, plus or minus. The store has had measures of success and also measures of challenges. We've learned a lot from that, and now we are building a team within our organization very much aligned with the Wrangler brand product teams to bring the Wrangler brand to life in a full price retail store format that will be successful. So you'll hear more about that in the coming weeks and expect to see a store open this fall. Blue box relocations. I think all of you recognize the fact that the blue boxes no longer fit nicely into our portfolio. They are in, many of them, are in challenged locations where traffic is a challenge. There's very little co-tenancy around us for reasons for people to come. In most cases, we're the only store in that destination. So we're working hard to try and find markets and stores within the same geographic location that we can move those stores to a more productive area. Probably one of the biggest success stories we had was last year moving our Union City, Tennessee store from a historic Blue Box location. We moved it literally about 2 miles into more of the main street of town, and we've seen tremendous success. You know, double-digit comp increases from doing nothing but moving the store and shrinking it from 47,000 square feet down to 30,000 square feet. We would have made it smaller and it wouldn't have mattered, but because of this real estate space that was available, it made sense just to cut it in half, and then we got this larger space for the same price we would have paid for the smaller space, so we took it. But again, real big success happening there. And lastly, continuing to build new stores. We are excited to announce that we have Asheville, North Carolina, and Little Rock, Arkansas, both on the books this year. Springfield, Illinois is still out there. There's still some challenges with the site development, but that'll be another location that we would have to introduce this year. So we'll continue to look at new stores and new store locations where they make sense. Improving communication, big deal. all of you have met Alicia by now. She's hard at work in her office there, making huge inroads to introducing better and cleaned up communication. I think it's such a big statement. I can't say it's benefiting the stores because all the corporate office employees are telling me that it's benefiting them as well. It's forcing us to clean up our database, our instruction manuals, and you know, having them into a consistent, clean, well-written format and into an organized database that'll be leveraged through the Loop. And I think it's official now, our Loop will be called the Pocket. So if you want to know where to get the information, you'll go to your pocket. And all the information will be contained there.
That's right. Look in your pocket.
Look in your pocket. That's where all the information is. Kind of a cute name. Institutionalizing innovation. Again, as I talked about that earlier, we're going to roll that out to the entire organization and figure out a way that everyone can participate in the process of innovation. Because remember, innovation is anything new that creates value. Reduce controllable expenses by 5%. We're going to forever challenge the organization to look for ways to be more frugal. We will invest money and spend money as it makes sense, but we're also going to look for opportunities to for waste and for efficiency. So we're going to challenge the organization to really look at expenses and to make sure we spend our money wisely. And then lastly, we would be remiss if we didn't forever focus on building great teams. And that is through the development and training of our existing people and through the very keen eye of recruitment to bring in new talent that can help strengthen the organization and take us to new places.
Good morning, everybody. I will be going through the finance, accounting, and real estate objectives. But first, I wanted to just start off with the 2015 plan overview. The first thing I would point out is for the 15 numbers, they were actually given to us by corporate. This is basically their numbers for us. And I would tell you that $278 million is an easy plan. I think we'll have no problem beating this plan that they gave to us. We were prepared to load about $287 million is what our proposal was. So there's a couple things where the differences, there's really two reasons. One is Sunrise. So some you may know or not know, but we own the building in Sunrise, and it's currently being proposed to sell to Simon, who is the landlord of Sawgrass Mills. And so while the plan was being developed, there was a little bit of a question of whether would we keep the store, would we not keep the store. So at the time, the sales plan was pulled down a little bit to account for a little bit of risk. But we know now, and we've seen the terms of the sale, that that store will stay in place for the full year. So immediately we have an add-on right to the 278 that's already going to put us above our plan just by putting Sawgrass back in. It's good news for us because obviously we get it for the full year and also gives us time to look for an alternate site to keep it right there in the Sunrise area. So that's really the one of the big reasons. The second reason is the sales comp. So corporate came back and said that we should be at a flat comp. We've seen our sales momentum. Rick talked about it. We've seen our history over the last three quarters. We've seen how January and February have started. We have strong momentum and we do have a very positive comp. So what we're thinking is we should be more in the 1.5% comp range. And so just those two factors alone, I mean, we think $290 million is very reachable this year. So that just to give you an idea of what we're looking at for revenue, from a gross margin standpoint, last year we're at 39.7%. We're looking at 41.6, so excellent job, almost 2 percentage points raised in the margins. Really the biggest story there is the distressed margins in 2014 on the Lee distressed product. We don't expect that to happen again in 2015. We expect to go back to more of a historical level, and just by doing that should get us to the 41.6. From a expense standpoint, we're pretty much flat. You see our percentages, 36.7 versus 36.8. So we're holding our expenses in line to where we experienced in 2014. And actually, once we raise our sales, especially if we can get that comp growth, you'll really see that expense percent start to decline. We'll be leveraging our expenses. So overall profit, 4.8%. We're going to make a lot more money than we did in 14, which is good news for the corporation. We're looking to get back to 2013, which I think can happen, especially if we can hit that $290 million revenue number. And something I should have pointed out for 2014, that was 53 weeks it took to hit that 289. So really, if you look at a 52-week basis, that 2014 should have been 285. So going from 285 to 290 would be solid for us.
Yeah, I'll just pause there for a second, and I'll go on record now because we're being recorded. So I'll go on record now and make this declaration, all right? The executive team here has stretch goals in place. We have initiatives that we believe when they're fully activated, all right, will actually take our revenue to $295 million in 2015 and generate $20 million of profit, all right? So you can look at the numbers up there, and you can look at the numbers I just quoted you, all right? And I think we have a realistic chance of having a revenue target of $295 million and generating $20 million in profit. So this organization is on the move, and everyone has to be believing in that and taking actions that are driving towards big, big growth on both top and bottom line. So that's the numbers we're going to hit.
300.
Charge.
Okay, 300 million. Wow, I love it. Okay.
We are 305.
Sold.
Right, Kevin?
So the overall department objectives for finance, accounting, and real estate, and actually it was good to hear Rick give a lot of history on, or give a little background on the coalition objectives, because you're going to hear a lot of these same objectives being listed here in finance. But obviously, number one, we want to hit our financial targets. Number two, inventory will be important for us. We want to support our new initiatives. Controls, obviously very important in accounting. We want to continue to innovate and drive efficiencies. Real estate, very important for VFO as we look at our portfolio. And we also want to ensure a culture of collaboration and ongoing learning and development. As Rick mentioned, building great teams. And that's really what the last objective is all about. So breaking down the financial targets a little bit. So you already heard this, reduce controllable expenses by 5%. Ensure department and store expenses are within budget. The third one is around our tent sales. I mean, I think this would be an interesting project to look at. Obviously, it's one of the things that we do that creates a lot of buzz and a lot of excitement for our customers. We can generate a lot of sales in about 3 to 4 days and move a lot of distressed units. But the reality is that it is a lower margin, and there is a lot of investment and expense to support these tent sales. So do we have the right amount? Do we do the right amount? Should we do more? Should we do less? Do we do too much investment, or should we do less investment? So I think it'd be a good project just to look at that, just to understand the tent sales, what they could be. The next one is improve forecast capability and accuracy. It's very important for us. Us as a finance really need to be engaged with the department managers, really understanding what our expenses are, getting that transparency, just really working closely with them, and it'll help us understand the business, understand the drivers that are really driving the expenses, and it'll help us understand our forecasts and really what we're aiming towards. And the last one here, increase visibility to store performance and profitability. This is all about our store scorecards. I know Chris has been wanting this, and I know the store managers really want this. We want to be able to give them their P&L so they really understand where their store is performing, and also they'll give them a sense of ownership and accountability to really understand how can they impact their performance. Inventory management, shrink, obviously a very big deal. When we think about inventory, we think about our inventory dollars. We want to come in below plan. When we think about days on hand, we want to reduce the amount of inventory we have on hand. And when we think about turns, we want to increase our turns. We want to constantly be bringing in that fresh new inventory all the time. Shrink, very important for us, obviously from a physical inventory standpoint, but also just through the course of the year. we have different inventory adjustments and different things that hit our shrink reserve, and we really need to understand what is hitting our shrink reserves and what kind of inventory adjustments we're having throughout the year. So that we'll be looking at some objectives of how do we get better visibility to that. And we had a whole lot on this slide. I love this slide.
Wow.
Because we have so many initiatives going on. And I think the cool thing about this, if you look through these, so many of these are cross-functional type initiatives. So they're really not finance-led. It's really us in finance trying to support. I think that's really what finance is all about, is to support the business and really be engaged in the business. So if you look at really the first two is around marketing. The first one is with Henry, the customer engagement 2.0. This is a big initiative for us. It's using the VIP data to get the customer contact information and be able to speak to them on a frequent basis. We're trying to move our new customers to permanent customers. We're trying to move our lapsed customers. Hey, don't forget about us. And so we're sending out triggers and different emails to speak to them. So we really want to support that. It's a big deal. There's quite a bit of investment obviously involved in order to do that. The analytics tool for marketing, I mean, this is really around APT, and we really want to use this tool and utilize it and really understand the promotions that we're doing and really understand the paybacks. PCI compliance. So PCI is payment card industry. This is all about the credit card industry. You hear it in the news all the time about some breach with credit card data. It's a big deal for us. EMV, chip and pin, it's a new technology. They're going from credit cards with a magnetic strip to having a chip. So it's supposed to help with fraud. It's supposed to safeguard your information a lot better. So we're basically on the edge of this technology, and we really need to learn and implement this new technology. The TMS freight reporting, this is the transportation management system. So we're just now getting good reports, good cost data, and we really need to use these reports. I think there's a huge opportunity. There's some quick wins working with Pete and getting some of these freight costs under control and seeing what we can do. CAS freight bill pay. This is a third party freight bill pay. We can realize savings in our processing fees. Also, I think CAS can do a much better job in auditing our freight bills, so I think there's opportunity there. We've heard about APT. Many of you have been in APT. There's a test and learn module that we're going to use for the price optimization, which Rick already talked about. I think that'll be excellent learnings for us. We'll really support finance and try to be more scientific and analytical in analyzing these events. Support the transition of payroll and accounting from PeopleSoft to Workday. So obviously there's a big move from PeopleSoft to Workday as we process our payroll. Accounting relies heavily on the PeopleSoft reports. We also get GL feeds. We want to make sure that all that's in place when we move to Workday. And then finally, the Wrangler store format. I don't think we need to talk any more about that, but that'll be a big deal. We need to support that with reporting and also systems. The maintaining controls. So in accounting, obviously this is not exciting and we don't really like doing this, but it's very important. And so really, this is the things you have to do in order to be successful in accounting. So we have to review our policies and ensure our procedures are up to date. You heard about Alicia rolling out the new migration from our document library to our intranet. So we really want to standardize our accounting policies and take that opportunity to update as needed and support her as we make that move. We want to ensure job descriptions are all up to date. The park tenant process, this is something we really need to look at, our industrial park tenants, our income, our accounts receivable, making sure we have a solid process in place. Ensuring timeliness for our accounting or for completing our bank and account reconciliations, very important for us as well. And preparing the enterprise risk assessment. This actually came from Jeansware. They want us to identify our top 10 risks to VFO, and then we need to think about what kind of controls can we put in place, what can we do to mitigate that risk. So that'll be a project for 2015. Innovate and drive efficiency. So just as we go through our day-to-day operations, when you really need to think about, are we adding value? Sales tax process is something we have to do. We're not the experts at it, but I mean it's something that we really need to look at and really understand the processes or ways that we can be more efficient. Our budgeting and month-end closing process, it's a big drain on us. It takes a lot of time. Is there ways that we can be more efficient in that process? And then the balance sheet review, best practices. This is something we're going to do. We're going to team up with Imageware, Jeanswear, and obviously us to identify our balance sheet review. What's our best practices in place? We meet twice a year with corporate to go over all of our balance sheet accounts. So is there a best practice, is there a standardized format that we can use to go through that process? The next one is real estate. So we talked quite a bit about real estate already. Obviously, we want to execute our 2015 real estate. For 2016 and 17, we need to be thinking about that now. We need to be identifying our sites. We need to be getting approval from the corporation. Rick already talked about testing new formats, the small format and the Wrangler stores. Rich is always heavily involved in managing our lease renewals to achieve the best terms for VFO. Continuing to leverage loyalty program for customer identification. So we get an idea from our loyalty data, what kind of demographics and where our customers are coming from. And when we look at our sites, we want to make sure that we're matched up so that we set ourselves up for the best success that we can have when we move into a new site. And obviously we want to maximize the value of our own property as well. And the last one I have is really about creating great teams. We want to collaborate with our internal and our external partners, including Jeanswear in that. Cross-train individuals on key functions and development succession plans. We want to engage our associates in stretch assignments and opportunities. Create development plans for all associates and also deliver continuous feedback on performance.
Nice job, Matt.
Good morning, everyone. So 2015 merchandising objectives. Can you just go to the first detailed page rather than going through everything twice. So in merchandising, the number one most important thing we do every single day is achieve our financial goals. And that includes sales, gross margin, turnover, and our distressed units. So the first thing, and we talk about this all the time, and we've been doing it for years and years, and we'll keep doing it forever, is to utilize all of our merchandise processes that we have in place. And we've really put these in place over almost a decade now. It's a really long time. So our Arthur planning, key items, open to buys, assortment planning, style outs, and everything else that we do. And this really allows us to ensure that we attain our financial goals. I mean, you guys who use these every single day, you know that this is the difference between us driving the business and the business just happening. And when you drive your business, you hit your goals. So it's really, really important. Number one, I can't illustrate enough how important that is. And then, you know, we all sit in meetings. We have weekly meetings, we have sporadic meetings, and I think every one of us has sat in a meeting throughout 2014 and years before, and there's something in the meeting that we get on the topic of talking about, and we all sit there and we say, God, I wish I just had a little bit more information, or I wish I would have looked at something a little bit differently. And that's not a bad thing, that's a good thing, because it allows us to continually improve the process. But for this year, I really want everyone to select one of those meetings or one of those moments that you sat there and said, God, I wish I had something, and really focus on improving the use of that within your business. And I want you to document what you want to improve about it and how you want to achieve it and what it will do to enhance your business. So I really want you to kind of reach back to a time when you sat there and you said, I wish I would have had X, and really document it. Next, I want everyone to maintain an initial markup log and overachieve the goal. And then continue to work closely with the e-commerce team. I mean, it's really important that we continue to support that business. There's a lot of operational things that that team has put into place to help improve kind of the functionality of the site and what the customer sees and the overall consumer experience. But it's also important that we help support kind of how we're merchandising that site.
You know, Deborah, probably a good place to interject a little bit on that topic is many of you may or may not have heard in the last week and a half or so, all right, VF Outlet, the entire e-commerce platform for Lee.com and Wrangler.com now reports into me. So Tari, who runs the e-commerce platforms for Wrangler, is a direct report to me. So I have been assigned the responsibility to help integrate all of the .com businesses into VF Outlet's DTC channel, right? So I think that statement got bigger and broader.
Yeah,
and even yesterday we talked about it in a, in another meeting, that the realities are that it's very expensive to make small production runs. But yet both businesses, the .com businesses and VF Outlet, need broader assortments. And by leveraging those two business opportunities together, we can help make some of these minimums more realistic as we work closer and closer together. So that challenge is bigger and broader than just our e-com. It's e-com across the entire Jeanswear platform.
Yep, really important. Number two, commercialize the VFO brand position in your business every day. You know, I think since I've been here, we talk about, you know, what do we do? I mean, we know what we do, but we never really put it into words, what we do at VFO every day. And now it's into words. But I really want you guys to take that overall kind of mission and the value statement, and I want to create your own. So what is it that you're going to do when you come into work every single day to create value for our customer? I don't care if you write it on a piece of paper and you put it on your wall, but I, you know, every single one of you run a different business. To you and your customer, value might mean different things. You know, if you're doing the Riders brand shop, you might decide that where you place your shop and how you merchandise it is the value you're going to offer. But what is it that you're going to do every day? Create Lee and Wrangler brand shops. I don't need to go into a lot of detail about this. I mean, Rick gave us a really... No, it's okay. It's good. He gave us a really good background on what we're working on. I mean, this doesn't really apply to every single person in merchandising, but every single person on the fifth floor, this is really important to. And it's equally important to our jeanswear brands. So just some things I want us to think about throughout the year is stay true to the brand vision, assuring that product crossover is minimized so revenue will be maximized. So if you're, you know, the ladies team and you're working on the Lee brand and the Riders brand and the Wrangler brand and you're selecting product and you're working with all these different partners, internal partners, external partners, we just have to make sure that we're keeping that brand vision clear so that we don't duplicate product efforts, because that's a waste of time, it's a waste of money, and at the end of the day, then we don't do more sales because of it. Work with VF Jeanswear and outside partners to deliver the best assortment through. So just to think about, and whether you verbalize it, you know, in your objectives, or you just keep it in mind, what is it that you can do to make it better and keep it fresh? Work with marketing and store ops to set shops and VFO doors to maximize productivity. I mean, that work has already started on the Rider side, and we're going to continue to roll that out to all the other brands that we talked about. Communicate frequently with all partners to assure timely delivery. I mean, this is kind of duh, but it's not really, because sometimes it's the most complicated thing that we do is just trying to get the goods that we have booked into our stores. that's sometimes actually by far the hardest part. Work on continual improvement cycle, delivering monthly bestsellers based on past performers. So there's a lot of new product that we're developing. There's a lot of new things hitting our floor. And it's going to take all of us really staying focused on what is working and what's not, so that we can build a portfolio of successes and maybe not so successful things. So as we continue the development cycle, we're always focusing on what worked and what didn't work to kind of keep it moving forward. Four, leverage price optimization. Rick talked about this. So, you know, our first test that we did in the last fall, I guess, we didn't really have the right basis to test upon, and we didn't get really good results. So we're going to put another test into place, and we're really going to test two things, I guess, 99-cent endings and what is their value. So if you put something at $9.99 up against an item, the same item at $10, does the $9.99 sell the product better than the $10 price point? And then in addition, is the 99-cent ending so powerful that you can actually take the price up a whole dollar? You can take your $10 item to $10.99 and the customer is blind to it. So it's really important in merchandising that as we get, you know, successes or maybe failures, that we really kind of adopt all those things into our process every day. And then in addition, I mean, this is something, you know, and I say to Rick all the time, we do this every day, is, you know, as you're selecting product and you're pricing product, really challenge yourself all the time. Can I get more for this item? Or if I upgrade this item just this much, can I get another dollar or another $2? And I think every one of the teams in 2014 had a time when they took an item up in price, some people more hesitant than others, and almost all of them worked. So just continue that even outside of the price optimization. Next, support store relocations and openings. I mean, this is what we do, but it's just important that we say it out loud because we have a lot going on this year. Each member of merchandising develop how they can enhance all VFO store openings through planning, product, great execution of mix and timing, and work with store planning, marketing, and stores on a timely basis to assure that product is highlighted with proper fixturing and new and exciting product is called out in marketing. And one thing I do want to say about us opening new stores and relocating stores is sometimes in the existing store and the existing format, we don't have the optimal fixturing for our product. So, you know, knowing those things, kind of working more frequently with the Chris's on those things, I think that we can continue to advance really how we enhance our products in the store. Continue to improve communication with stores and internal VF partners. And this in merchandising is also very, very important, is the internal VF partners. We're probably the place that touches Jeanswear more often than any other part of VF Outlet. So we kind of are the constant face of VF Outlet to Jeanswear. So it is really, really important that we have a very good relationship with them. But beyond that, I want everyone to work with Alicia, our store communications manager, on a frequent and ongoing basis to improve information flow to the stores. I think every single one of you in merchandising has worked with Alicia, and everybody loves Alicia. So I don't think that's going to be a problem. Seek to communicate new strategies and ideas through Alicia to continue to improve the business. So just an example of this is the footwear team. Sue and Stacy sat down with Chris and Alicia. You know, our footwear business, while we do a lot of volume, it has its challenges. And they sat down with Chris and Alicia and said, you know what, even though the overall business has challenges, we have a few stores who are really, really working. They're really doing a great job. So they really teased out what are those particular stores doing really well, and can we actually document what they're doing, and can we send out information to all the other stores that they can learn from. And the information that's gone out is really an amazing packet, and I really think that the stores are going to have no problem executing what's been put together. And the other thing that came out of that meeting was a whole brainstorm about pricing. So they went in thinking, you know, can we kind of send out, you know, pictures, or can we do something to help the stores set up the floor? But they walked out with a new pricing strategy that everyone's excited about, and it just became a much, I don't know, I guess more encompassing outcome than what we had thought. So everybody kind of keep that in mind, because they're a great source just to talk about business as well. Work with marketing to highlight new trends and launches, which I know our teams do really well. Assume positive intent in all communications with VF Jeanswear and work to eliminate communication barriers. And that's really just being transparent. I mean, it's our business. It's not a VFO business. It's VFO and Jeanswear. Continue on constant product and process improvement and innovation. I want every single person in the merchandising department to develop at least one innovation item that will offer value to our consumer while contributing to the overall financial goals. There is going to be a template, so you'll be able to document what that item is. You'll be able to kind of plot out where you should be on a timeline, and you'll be able to document, you know, how you do in terms of impacting the financials. And I don't want it to be a Super Wow or an after Thanksgiving item. That's kind of something that's already out there. So I really want it to be something that's very specific to your business. And then beyond that, as you guys, you know, you're exposed to a lot of other members of the team. If you think of other ideas that can enhance other businesses or something for finance or something for stores, let's document that too so we can get it shared. And then lastly, reduce travel spending by 5% from 2014 actual. So, I mean, really the only expense we have in merchandising is travel, and it is expensive to travel. So I want each team, the ladies, the men's, intimates, kids, planning an allocation to reduce travel spend by 5%, without reducing necessary time in market. I mean, our time in market is so, so important. But frequently, I know that there's days where, you know, a vendor cancels or we get ahead of schedule or, you know, an appointment that we have scheduled for an hour and a half, we're done in 45 minutes. Squeeze somebody else in so that we can reduce our total number of nights in New York. I mean, guys, you know what the prices are of hotels in New York. It's a fortune. So let's really work on consolidating those trips. Challenge vendors to come see us. I mean, we have a lot of vendors who love to come to Reading. Let's just continue asking them to come. And then assure that members of planning and allocation can add value to trips. We love having the whole team together. But some days when we're there, you know, I think maybe the allocators and the planners can be doing things that are more important to the business back in the office. So let's just make sure that we're having those conversations and we're really honest about it. That's all. We definitely want them to still be there, but we want to make sure that they can add value. And then use Doniger more than you may already use them.
Okay, good morning. Good morning. We're going to cover the objectives here for 2015, but just to reiterate back a little bit to 2014, you know, the last 7 months have been very exciting in the HR department. We've undertaken a lot of challenges. We have a great team in place right now, and we're really looking forward to kind of stabilizing in 2015 and really perfecting what is currently in place and certainly looking for opportunities going forward. We have four main objectives for this year. One is geared around partnership, one is HR operations, one is talent acquisition, and talent development. It's really important going forward. Some of the things within the partnership objective sound kind of back to basics. But really, as we're taking a look at how we've done business in HR and really the culture that we're trying to create and really becoming that advisor and consultant to all of you, we really want to make sure that we're taking the approach of being your partner. And what does that mean? It means that we're striving for consistent communication, and we've made great strides in that working with Alicia. We have weekly focus items that we talk about with all of the districts company-wide to ensure that consistent communication is happening. We're improving communication here on the fifth floor, which is very important, again, just to make sure that everybody is up to date and knows what is happening. Proactive versus reactive. A lot of times within HR, I refer to it as old school HR. HR was known for those paper pushing individuals, and I only call them if I need to term somebody. And so really what we're striving for is really to become more proactive versus reactive. We want to be your partner at the time that it's, you know, that it becomes important to you. So if it's brainstorming on how to run your business more effectively, if it's how to hire and recruit more creatively, again, it's something where we're going to be striving to meet with most of the department managers ahead of time, the store managers, to say, how is your business operating for you? What can we do to better support you from an HR perspective? So really looking for that partnership to really mold and form from the beginning rather than only in the time that you need us. Coach and train. There's a big difference between coaching and training someone. And so from our perspective, it's really taking this approach that we want to help coach you. We want to create a coaching mentality rather than we're gonna train you and tell you what to do, or we can empower you by asking questions and helping you come up with the solution rather than us just telling you this is how it needs to be done. So it's really having that shift to say, okay, you know, whether you're in a store and you're having to train someone, it's maybe giving you some creative alternatives. So it's maybe asking some different questions, taking a different approach with your workforce to really get to the optimal solution. Incorporate mission, vision, and core values in how we hire, develop, and manage our associates. The HR team from the beginning, and they will all tell you, they have heard us talking about value since the beginning. It's very important that we consistently demonstrate the value that we bring to the department on a daily basis, as well as the organization. We're constantly asking questions around, well, does this function bring value? Does this serve a purpose? And so even more so in 2015, we're really going to start to hone in and focus so that when we're making decisions, when we're talking to you on the fifth floor, when we're talking to the stores, you know, we're going to be asking those questions. Does it serve a purpose? Does it bring value to your business? When we're hiring somebody, you know, are they bringing the wow factor? Are they going to bring what you need to your team in order to drive your business? Commitment to know the business. I've challenged all the members of the HR team to get out of HR and go learn our business. It's very important if we're going to act as your advisor and your consultant that we understand the full capacity of VFO, why we do business, how we do business, what happens in merchandising, what's important to finance, walk in the shoes of a store manager or an RSA so that we can fully understand what it takes to function in those different capacities. Strategic thinking. You know, we had a conversation in HR at one point about what it means to be a strategic thinker. And, you know, we all at some point in our work day, in our work week, have an opportunity where we're thinking strategically, but we may just not know it. So it's really working with our team to identify those particular situations where we are acting in a strategic manner and what that looks like and how it can benefit the organization as a whole. Next is HR operations. Ensure efficiencies and processes benefit HR and our internal customers while meeting our financial targets and reducing expenses. This is an area that we're going to continue to enhance and perfect in HR. One of those starting points is Workday, and I know we've all experienced Workday over the last several months and some of the challenges that it has brought. Just keep in mind the end result. When we get to the end result, it will be a much easier, more effective system. April 1st, we are going live from a payroll perspective. So as of April 1st, PeopleSoft will be going away. So just another hurdle that we will get over here at the beginning of April. One of the stretch goals that HR is initiating this year along with store operations is we've made a commitment to reduce turnover. And what does that mean? It means that we're stating that we're going to reduce turnover company-wide by 15% for hourly associates and 10% for management or salary associates. So what does that equate to? It equates to about 320 hourly associates and about 30 salary or management associates. So let me just talk a little bit about this. Certainly there is good turnover and there is bad turnover. And we will help all of you identify what that looks like. At the same time, we want to make sure that we are giving our associates an opportunity to improve if they need to improve. But in those situations where it's either not an appropriate fit or we're just saying that it's not going to work, we don't want to not address issues. So this is a stretch goal. I believe that we can do it. I believe that by paying more attention to detail when we're hiring and selecting associates, if we continue to do what we do and create the environment where we're engaging our associates and we're offering them opportunity for development, that we should be able to really retain some great employees. So look for more information to come on that. We're also committing to reduce workers' comp costs through standardizing the process and managing more aggressively. So we're going to be really defining the work comp process here in the near future. And we're holding monthly conference calls with our insurance providers to ensure that they're staying on top of the claims and really managing them to the point of where we're working to get our employees back to work. We're going to continue to review HR policies and create consistency in the standards. Right now there are some HR policies that need to be revised, and there are some that we do not have currently that we'll be looking to put in place. And again, policies are not there to police our employees. They're there to provide structure and standard so that we are all clear on the expectations, around us. So we're going to be working to create and bring consistency in our HR policies. The HR team is also going to be identifying at least one opportunity for an innovative solution. And I say one opportunity, but it's really one opportunity from an HR operations perspective, from a talent development perspective, and a talent acquisition perspective. So we're going to be constantly doing what we do and looking for areas that we can bring continuous improvement, enhancement to what we're already doing. Maximize on recognition and retention programs to improve and heighten employee morale and reduce turnover. So again, in 2014, we kicked off several different employee recognition programs, and some of them fell by the wayside. This year, we're making a strong commitment to really hone in on employee recognition and retention. So we'll be focusing again on the retention programs and looking for opportunities where we can work to continue to enhance our culture, and in turn will retain our employees. Next is talent acquisition. Develop recruiting strategies that identify future hiring needs, source and select top talent, and deliver an employee value proposition that attracts and retains successful associates. So one of the big opportunities right now company-wide is really defining our recruiting process and what does that look like, so that when we have an opening, what are the steps that need to be followed. So we're going to be outlining a recruiting process, from start to finish, so that whether you're the hiring manager or an associate within the company, you will be able to know exactly what the process will be. We're going to develop an EVP, Employee Value Proposition Statement. And this is really talks to how we sell our company, so that as we're out there recruiting individuals, what sets us apart? What sets us apart from our competitors? And why would somebody want to come and work here? So it's really creating that selling statement, so that whether you're a store manager, somebody on the fifth floor, or one of us on the stage, as we're going through the interview process, you'll be able to really have a consistent message as to what VFO offers and why you should come and work for us. Succession plan process. We've started the beginning of this year really honing in on our succession plan process. All of our managers have been trained on performance management from the standpoint of 9-box and succession planning. But we really need to take it a couple steps further and really utilize the tool, so that when we have openings, when we have assistant manager store openings, or store manager openings, or a position here on the fifth floor, that we have a plan in place as to how to fill those positions internally rather than possibly going to the outside. Use most advantageous search engines to reach top talent. Again, we've really worked over the last 7 months to identify the different sites, social media and so forth, where we're getting the most candidates, the best candidates, and really where we're getting the most bang for our buck. And so we're going to continue to look at those recruiting sites and recruiting options, so that we can provide the most creative for our hiring managers. Onboarding process. Even though we've made some strides in this, it's really formalizing the process to say, okay, if we hire a retail employee, if we hire somebody on the fifth floor at the divisional office, what does that process look like? Do we have checklists in place for the hiring managers to follow and guide them through? Do we have an outline training plan for the new hire to complete within the first 30 days? What does all that look like? So this year, we're going to be really defining that process, both for fifth floor and for our retail stores. And the last item is behavioral-based interview guides. One of the things that we just implemented with the stores is we've identified what core competencies equal success in our retail stores. And so really this is going to be how we manage from start to finish in our stores, from a hiring perspective to how we manage performance, to how we look and stretch and come up with stretch goals. So one of the key initiatives for talent acquisition will be to create behavioral-based interview guides that will tie in with those competencies so that we're hiring for success right from the beginning. And the last one is talent development. Provide an environment of continuous learning that will strengthen leadership, identify growth opportunities, channel career advancement, and celebrate personal success. The first item there is training store certification. We're going to be identifying one store within each district that will be deemed as the training store for that district. This will be a certification process that the store will have to complete in order to be deemed a training store. But it's really working this year to develop the criteria around who qualifies and what we will be looking for and expecting from the training store, and then going through the actual certification process. We're going to be developing a store manager and assistant manager new hire training programs, again, to be able to identify, okay, what happens in the first 2 weeks that a store manager starts, what happens in the next 30 days, and so forth. Competency models, we're going to continue to drill down on the competencies for the various areas. Like I said, we just implemented and kicked off the competency models for the retail stores. Now the goal is to carry that throughout the organization. Performance management, again, we're going to continue to focus on performance management from a review standpoint, the 9-box and succession plan. It's not just a once a year effort. So it's really looking and saying, okay, what does the process need to be and how do we get there? Training needs implementation. All of you are aware that at the end of last year, we completed a training needs analysis. Stephanie has compiled that information, and we're going to be sharing that with all of you here shortly, and developing a training plan both for retail stores and the fifth floor for 2015 based on those results. Thanks.
All right, good morning. How's everybody doing?
Good morning.
All right, store operations objectives. So I can honestly say that our operational objectives for 2015 were driven from the Innovation Summit last year in May, right? Beginning of May. So everything that we've been doing this fall and this winter has been leading up to try to prepare for the results that we're going to deliver from a store operations perspective in 2015. And it really was about simplifying and streamlining what we do each and every day, making it easy for everyone to understand and execute. So from an operations perspective, we've aligned ourselves with the Jeanswear objectives. You can go ahead, Michaela, and go to the next one. So simply, achieve financial targets, achieve sales goal. I guess Deborah says we're up to $300 million now, so I'm glad I didn't write a number in, because it might change by the end of the meeting. So we'll see how that goes. Achieve or reduce our shrink goal. So we had awesome shrink in 14, but we look to improve on that. And achieve distressed unit goal through tent sales, through managing WOW product, things of that nature. Store operation, execute strategic initiatives. So I put some acronyms in here, and hopefully I'll explain those. I guess I should have spelled them out so it'd be easier. But achieve or exceed the VIP goal. So let me get to the right page. To green status. And what that means is I've been working with Henry on this. We've set our goals for 2015. We're looking for an increase in our business, in our VIP acquisition. I did some quick math on this and one of my stretch goals. For last year, we did 46% overall store penetration in VIP. If we would achieve a 48%, or if we would have increased it from 46 to 48, that's $2.5 million in top line sales just for a 2% increase. So I put 48 as my stretch goal, but 50 is really the number I want to go for. I know that we have a couple of districts
that...
Okay,
it's 300.
Well, there's another 5 million right there. There's your 300, so yeah. But we have a couple districts that achieved over 50% year-to-date last year. So it's out there. We can do this.
It's doable.
It is. Meet or exceed in-moment store index scores. So that's our... That's how we receive our customer feedback. We, the Empathica company switched to a new name, InMoment. They were acquired by the InMoment group. And basically, we are going to look at improving our customer feedback, the store index scores that we get. execute VMG storefront guide and adjacencies per direction. So we're going to, as we work with Michaela and the marketing team, we're working at making it easier for the teams, and we're going to have the teams execute those at a higher level and a more timely level and more consistent level. Local marketing, build brand awareness and loyalty through local events. So this is a cool one. This is kind of new for this year. We're actually documenting a lot of our local marketing activities. We're asking stores to do 6 events, 4 minor events, and 2 landmark events. Landmark meaning bigger, more expansive. We've given them some money to go out and partner in their communities and bring some awareness that we're still there, we're still viable, we still want you to come in and shop with us. So we are asking them to document their local marketing events, and really we're going to see what kind of ideas we can gather from that and see where we can leverage that as we move forward in our business. Consistent execution. So SVG means store visit guide, and EVG means executive visit guide. So this is where the district managers and the executive team, when we go into stores, we evaluate their ability to execute our practices and our procedures and policies. And we score them through an evaluation system that we do online, and we track those scores and track the progress of each store. So we've established a green, yellow, and red status based off the level of execution. So we want to achieve that green status throughout all of our stores. Institutionalized innovation. Just as you've heard from everybody else, we're implementing here very quickly an innovation practice to organize how the stores come up with new ideas and feed that information up through Alicia and through myself, and how we can get that out to the stores once we get good ideas. We're going to be asking the stores, just as everybody else is asked to document and come up with ideas, we're going to do the same thing in the stores. We're going to ask them to try, test, maybe evaluate their store's performance or evaluate the way their stores operate and come up with new ideas that can help drive efficiency in the rest of our stores. And B simply is cost, deliver benefits with fewer resources or become more efficient. That's really what that means. Reduce controllable expenses by 5%. Once again, as we do each and every year, manage payroll performance at or below budget. We're very good at that. We're going to maintain that as we move forward. Another piece that we've added, though, is manage controllable expenses to meet or underspend allowed budget. This includes employee welfare, supplies, travel, and entertainment. So these are controllable expenses at the store level. We've already implemented budgeting, kind of a checkbook system that they can use in their stores to keep track of how their spending is going. And we've given them a budget for the year, too, so they have a limit that they can spend to, so they can plan their year out as to how they spend for employee welfare or travel, entertainment, or supply expenses as we work with Chris and his team. And build a great team. Reduce associate turnover percent from previous year. I think that Michelle spoke to that. We're working together on achieving that stretch goal and just improving our turnover and building on the experience that we currently have. Maintain appropriate staffing levels and recruit and hire talent in a timely manner. So we've already started tracking our open positions. We send out a report weekly to the teams. They know where they are and how long that they've been open. We're looking for creating ways that we can attract talent and fill our positions quicker, either through succession planning or through an action plan in regard, like a written action plan or a strategy into how we're going to maybe fill some of the more difficult locations that we have with our open positions. Performance management, this is about our performance assessment meetings, our jeans assessments. A jeans assessment is where we actually evaluate our associates on their ability to give customer service to the customer. Our performance plans and attendance management. So this is what I'm challenging the stores here with this objective, is to really take a look at how you're managing performance in the store, all the way from attendance to how our associates are behaving in the stores with the customers and how they're achieving the work that we're asking of them, and to do it in a more efficient, positive way. And then finally is succession planning. So as Michelle spoke of earlier there too, it's really determining how we fill open positions and who is the next in line for that position. How do we develop them to get ready for that role? And that is it for our store operations.
All right, so now Chris, we're to planning an industrial park. So as we get into 2015, you'll find a lot of overlapping objectives. I mean, we're all rolling up to one, you know, these common objectives. Store planning is really a supporting role in a lot of these. So as we get into the store planning objectives, really it's plan and execute brand shops. We've seen that already. Plan and execute the 2015 real estate plan. You know, that's part of it. Execute capital projects for the 2015 capital plan. Realize 5% reductions in controllable expense accounts. Plan and execute sustainability initiatives. And also execute industrial park division office cleanup and efficiency initiatives. So we'll get into more detail on these. As we get into plan and execute brand shops, it's really, again, a supporting, you know, function. It's cross-coalition. It's, you know, within our own departments. It's really documenting the project scope and budget, establishing benchmarks and timelines, fixture and adjacency development, and coordination and execution. So it's really, you know, helping to bring all those pieces together so that we can, you know, effectively execute these brand shops into the stores. Plan and execute the 2015 real estate plan. It's really updating and publishing new store specifications, executing against timelines and budgets, and supporting Wrangler store development. Now the Wrangler store, you know, that's going to be a big piece of what we're, you know, currently working on. A lot of effort going into that cross coalition, a lot of you know, people working on the brand essence design. We're going to be, you know, working with the team to execute the two Wrangler stores this year, and then also carrying that forward into 16 and 17, because when these are successful, we're going to gain momentum and, you know, really develop this concept and this brand. The rest of the real estate plan, we have Asheville, we have Little Rock already on the books. We're working on those feverishly. A lot of other things that real estate is working on, you know, getting the leases and getting some things firmed up so that as we go through the year, that's really going to be a moving target as it usually is. So as we add stores, we'll support that real estate objective. Execute capital projects for the 2015 capital plan. Really, our capital plan mostly is in new stores, relocations, supporting the real estate strategy, but also the DTC remodels and maintenance. What does that mean? You know, I've got a few acronyms here as well. We've heard, you know, AVG, VIP, no. I have DTC and I have HVAC. So DTC remodels and maintenance, really it's just how do we maintain the stores? Bathroom remodels, making sure that those touch points for the customers, those pieces of value that we can add to their shopping experience are maintained appropriately and brought up to, you know, current specifications. HVAC, really heating and air conditioning. You know, making sure that, you know, we are very smart about our decisions with these capital investments. HVAC is expensive. You know, to replace a unit, it's $15,000-$20,000. They break all the time. So really just making sure that we're, you know, value engineering that and making sure if we repair, replace, that's part of that program. Fixtures, visual enhancements, again, as we get into the year, you know, we have these brand departments being pulled together. We usually have other initiatives, you know, through merchandising, through marketing, through operational initiatives that we need to support with fixtures and adjacencies, you know, fixture development if fixtures don't exist, and, you know, really bringing that together. And then, you know, fitting rooms. You know, big touch point for the customers. We still have some fitting rooms that have old carpet, you know, so you really don't want to take your shoes off, or you're, you know, standing on your shoes because you don't want to touch the carpet. Things like that, you know, just those pieces that really detract from the customer experience. We want to continue that momentum and that progress over what we've already made. Realizing 5% reductions in controllable expense account. Has anybody seen this on a previous slide? 5% is what we're going to reduce as a minimum. I feel that as our team, you know, takes a look at our initiatives, we innovate, we find the value for the customers, I plan on exceeding this. A couple of areas, supply accounts, you know, very critical. You know, as we take a look at price optimization, obviously, if you change a price, it requires a tag. You know, we need to make sure that we're partnering with merchandising, with operations to make sure supplies are there. You know, even with in-store purchasing of office supplies and other things, we want to make sure that we're providing the right value and right controls so that we can lower those costs. Reactive services and service channels. Service channels are really a work order system for our stores, where, you know, if they have a lock that's broken or, you know, anything, lights are out, they issue a work order and, you know, we react to that. It's a reactive service. So just making sure that, you know, within the store environment that we're challenging and asking the right questions so that if we can self-perform, maybe we save that $450 service call of a tech going out to service that. Direct vendor relationships, this is important too. It's easy to call somebody and say something's broken and there's national vendors out there that will service all of your stores. Our challenge is not using those national vendors. It's easy, it's not cheap. So they're basically brokering and there's like about a 15% overhead. Well, the more direct relationships we have, the more of that 15% we can take back. So that's what that piece is. Utilities, EMS, another one, energy management system, and wireless submetering. Utilities, big for the park. You know, we spend over $1 million in utilities. So unoccupied spaces, we're trying to, you know, make sure that we're not lighting and heating those unoccupied spaces to make more efficient use of our resources. EMS, we have energy management systems, which basically turn on and off the air conditioning and also the lights, basically what it does. So it just automates that so that we, you know, don't go in first thing in the morning, flip on the lights. So tightening those controls, making sure the right processes are in place. And wireless submetering, something we're trying. At the end of this year, we have some stores that, you know, there's a certain amount of investment required for an energy management system. Wireless submetering, a low cost of entry, just a couple $1,000s. And we can take a look at how that store performs from a utility standpoint. Exciting stuff, I know, but you can take a look and see how much they're using for lights, how much they're using in electric, how much their HVAC. Then we can take a look at their practices and just create a best practices, partner with Alicia and the operations team, and how do we roll that out and those learnings to other stores at zero incremental cost. So how do we change behaviors in the store? IP, utilities, fuel, HVAC, lighting, you know, you guys live it every day. You know, at the industrial park and even in the office, how do we, you know, make better decisions with the energy we're consuming? Travel expense, you know, there's a lot of travel out there, so just being smart about it. And as Deborah, you know, challenged her team, I'm challenging my team. If you can, you know, shorten by a day, you know, it saves money. Contract management. Really just taking a look at contracts that are in place, you know, especially like in Reading. You know, we have ADT, we have you know, all kinds of elevator contracts, pest control. They haven't really been looked at in a long time. They've kind of auto-renewed. So let's go back and let's push back. Let's find, you know, the savings in those contracts. Rebate programs, corporate waste. This is part of sustainability piece, but also making sure that our stores are getting credit for rebates that are out there for recycling, you know, cardboard and reducing waste expense. Plan and execute sustainability initiatives. Conclude the waste RFP. That's a, you know, we've got a bid out there in the procurement team at corporate to select a waste provider for all of the coalitions. We need to conclude that so that we can, you know, really hone in on what services are needed at what stores. Store level recycling practices. Again, this came out of the innovation committee and meeting back in May. Really, you know, how can we help the stores institute a common recycling program to save waste costs and to, you know, feel good about our sustainability initiatives. Paper and receipt reduction, kind of, we have this, you know, pieces in place, you know, for that, to reduce our the amount of receipt tape. We produce thousands of miles of receipt tape and consume thousands of miles of receipt tape throughout the year. Even if we make small changes, it can make a big difference, not only in cost, but also sustainability. And innovate, you know, really, again, we've been preaching innovation for a long time. What is it? You know, something new that provides value, you know, something incremental we do. Really just go out and take a look at what we do and challenge it and question where we can save. Execute IP division office cleanup and efficiency initiatives. Electronic record retention, new to all of you guys. If you were to walk our property and go down into the bowels of Reading, there are mountains upon mountains of records and papers dating back from the 1900s until current day. You know, there hasn't been a real reason to get rid of it because we have space, but now we're really, you know, trying to, you know, whittle that down and really become more efficient. How many times have, you know, somebody in finance or something, accounts payable, you know, I need to go find that record. You got to stop what you're doing, and, you know, it takes you 30 minutes to go find that. With this electronic record keeping, it will make us more efficient. You'll have that at your fingertips, and within seconds you can query records that you need, you know, for whatever. Plus, it helps with the cleanup effort. And Chief, all that paper could probably fuel the boiler house for about a month, but that's not an initiative we want. You know. So as we start, you know, getting rid of this, we'll recycle, you know, in an effective manner and really help with that initiative. Unoccupied space cleanup, again, going to all the spaces in Reading. You know, it's no secret we've been, you know, trying to sell the property, and pretty soon we're going to have to, you know, live within our own spaces, you know, once, you know, we find an appropriate buyer and we start living within our means. So, you know, we want to start that cleanup effort now. There's a lot of old tenant spaces that have just had fixtures and miscellaneous things sitting around for years. We're going through and, you know, getting money out of the metal, you know, is an innovative thought, and just trying to prepare ourselves for that. Curb appeal projects. As you drive up past the property, you know, what do you see? You know, do you see a rusty fence line? Well, you know, customers see that too. Are there ramps that are in disrepair? Are there, you know, trees or landscaping that needs to be done? Those are things that we really want to enhance, you know, to provide a better value for the customers here. And then supply and work area modifications, just making sure, again, that we're making efficient use of our space.
Thank you, Mark. All right, and this is where we spend it all. actually, no, you know, our in marketing, our main goal, our main objective, day in and day out, is to really drive the traffic to the stores that will enable us to get to the targets that we need to get at. So actually, I'm particularly proud of the, you know, the effort that we've done last year and this year. I'm really focusing on the initiatives that do exactly that. That is, drive the customers to the stores. Whether it was our customer engagement strategy, whether it was the email communication that Allison puts out every week. So I think we've done a great amount of work really on focusing on those initiatives that drive the traffic to the store. So going through the objectives for this year, what we have identified is execute marketing initiatives to impact the KPI so that we can achieve our financial targets, and those KPI are predominantly traffic and conversion. Design and execute shop-in-shop environments for Lee and Wrangler. We're going to continue to refine and improve the in-store experience. We're going to execute marketing programs in support of the new Wrangler store. We're going to execute the next level of CRM strategy with the launch and optimization of the customer engagement 2.0. We're going to reduce marketing administrative budget just to be in line with everybody's goal. And ultimately, although this is listed as the last initiative, but actually it's the first, but I have that because it segs into, it's a good segue into the brand positioning statement that we're going to conclude the session with, which is developing programs, platforms, and processes to commercialize the new brand positioning. So as we talk about these new initiatives, really it's all about driving the traffic to the stores, right? It's about driving the traffic to the store, increasing the conversion, and also, you know, being able to raise the AURs by, you know, how we display product, right? Because that can help us command a higher price. So we're going to capitalize on all local marketing opportunities to drive traffic. We've done a considerable amount of work last year, really getting us to the point where we fully capable of capitalizing on that. We've partnered with all the mall operators and all the mall managers to identify paid opportunities as well as free opportunities, whether it's their social media platform, so that every time we have something of interesting to say, something of value to communicate, whether it's a super wow, whether it's a sale, whether it's a special program, we can leverage those tools at the local level, at the mall level. Through this initiative. So very, very excited about that. Then we're going to develop engaging social media content that drives traffic to store website. This year we focus really on the really summarizing the social media content to really speak to what we do best, which is the values that we offer in our store. So that's what we're going to be focusing on all the platforms, whether it's Facebook, whether it's Twitter, whether it's Instagram. It's really calling out those special initiatives that we have going in the store so that they can drive customers to go to either the website or to the stores to take advantage of those initiatives. We are going to continue to improve in-store product presentation so that we can improve conversion while allowing for higher AURs. I mean, it's no secret that, you know, the better we display product, the better we style it, the better we coordinate it, the better the conversion is going to be, because the customer is going to be cued to purchase a specific outfit because they need that sort of guidance. But also by the way we present the product, the way the more sophisticated we make the presentation, the higher price we can command. So an ongoing initiative, but nonetheless an extremely important one that we've come a long way in these last 3 years. So we want to push even further on that as well. We want to develop compelling email marketing campaigns to drive traffic. No secret, our email marketing has been one of our most successful initiatives. It's really, really working for us. The results are, tangible. They're there for us to see. Whether it's when we do a Super Wow initiative, we can see the results right there and there. So we just want to continue on this path and really get a little bit even more smarter through. Perhaps customizing the communication. So, and then also we want to continue to support the e-com business with effective marketing content. You know, we're working very closely with Randy and his team on really, developing content in support of really what gets featured on the e-com store, and really being able to be in sync with what's, what we offer in our stores as well. So. Number two, design and execute shop-in-shop environments for Lee and Wrangler. I think we can all agree that the Rider Shop experiment was a really, really successful one. I mean, the numbers really told the story. And we had a big enough sample. It was about 10 stores that we really singled out to really get sort of a special or an increased level of visual support to stand out from the rest of the stores. And obviously, the customers, migrated towards that shop, and the results were very encouraging, to the point that we're going to have a meeting very soon to discuss the extent of how we how much we're going to roll it out to how many other doors. So the same approach we want to also extend to the Lee shop, the Lee shop, as well as also the Wrangler women and the Lee dungaree. So we, in the next couple of months, we're going to be determining the extent of that involvement. But we're very, very excited because we're really creating these branded environments within our store that that customers are really, really connecting with. So continue to refine and improve the in-store experience. Like I said, we've done a huge amount of work in this area. You can see the difference if you walk into our store compared to maybe 2-3 years ago. There's definitely it's a much more dynamic environment. It's a much more engaging, it's a much more appealing environment. There's more visual stimulus, there's mannequins, there's graphics, there's cross merchandising. So everything that really, delivers to the certain expectation that the customer has this day and age in the marketplace. So So we're going to keep improving the window program with consistent value messaging and increased product assortment. We did a really interesting experiment with last denim month when we brought product into the window. The customers responded really, really well. So we're going to do it again with seasonals coming up in March. And the idea is to really showcase really what are two strengths, which is value and assortment. So, and we've done that in the last two initiatives, and the goal is to really push forward on this end. So we're going to further develop visual merchandising tools such as the scarf tutorial video to better help the store teams with their visual presentation skills. I think we have a lot of know-how at the corporate office when it comes to styling the product, merchandising it, and the goal is to really do more of that sharing with the field. So that the store teams are feel empowered and feel also in charge and capable to execute these styling tips, these merchandising tips. We are going to leverage all field opportunities such as the Lancaster sessions or the new store openings to provide training in display techniques. We have those great opportunities there where we have a broader range of talent coming to the store, whether they're store managers from different districts. And I always say this is a great opportunity to really, showcase, display techniques, and so we're going to continue leveraging that. And then ultimately, we're going to work closely with the communication manager in streamlining the communication and identifying opportunities for new forums or platforms where to share info. And that could be SharePoint, it could be the Loop, in this case, the Pocket. Just being able to identify opportunities for us to share information, because there's so much information that we need to get out into the field, but it's just about creating the opportunities to do so. Number four, execute marketing programs in support of the new Wrangler store. Super exciting initiative. We are going to work closely with the merchandising manager in developing a calendar that's in sync with all the merchandising activities. It's not going to be any different than how we do it today with the rest of the merchandising group with our VF outlet stores. It's going to be about putting together a marketing calendar, identifying all the opportunities, all the programs, all the launches, all the new deliveries, all the new holidays that need to be supported, just the same way we support them in the with our regular VF outlet stores. So it's going to be a parallel initiative that we're going to be working very closely with Jennifer. Then we're going to develop a sign kit program and a POP package specifically for the Wrangler store. We are going to coordinate with Jeanswear, and that's specifically with Craig's group, on all the creative and the presentation material for the window and the in-store programs. I think it's extremely important that we coordinate and sync with the brand, because they obviously own the brand narrative and the creative work behind us. I think it's important that we stay in sync with them. And then ultimately, we're going to launch a dedicated CRM environment for Wrangler stores. Obviously, they're going to use the same POS system, so we're going to be able to use our CRM platform, but we're just going to create a partition environment, CRM environment, that's going to allow us to pull the necessary CRM data that's specifically to the Wrangler store. Execute the next level of CRM strategy with the launch and optimization of the customer engagement 2.0, which we launched last July very, very successfully. Really what it was the opportunity to minimize the lapsing behavior of our customer and really increase the frequency of communication with those customers, really providing the opportunity and the excuse to really come visit us again through the offering of promotions, through trigger emails and direct mail. So we want to achieve a 5 million target specified in the strategic initiatives. Based on the redemption attached to the coupons for the customer engagement strategy that we launched last July, in the last half of the year, we think we can achieve a $5 million redemption sale attached to the coupons for the 2.0 strategy that we're going to do this year. So we're going to try to achieve that goal. We're going to continue to improve the quality of the data captured. Extremely, extremely important. The more data we know, the better quality data we have, the easier we can reach out to the customer. And we know that once we reach out to the customer, they respond by coming to our store. So we're going to continue building the database size while decreasing the percentage of lapsing new signups, which currently sits at 65%. We're going to identify further subsegmentation opportunities to lay the foundations for 2.1. Obviously, you know, we're in the process of executing 2.0, but I want us to be aware of what the next, start thinking about what the next opportunity is. So Henry's going to work on identifying what the next opportunities are within the existing subsegmentation strategies. And ultimately, we're going to develop a parallel strategy for optimized segment migration. We don't want to focus only on the new VIPs, right, and their lapsing behavior, but we also want to focus on the other segments, right, and understand what can we do to trigger, to foster movement from less profitable segments to better, to more profitable segments. So we're going to work on a strategy that's going to address that as well. Number six, we're also going to be contributing to the overall goal of reducing expenses by 5%. So we're really going to focus on two areas, which is the traveling for us, which is the biggest culprit, the biggest component of our expenses, right? But also we're going to also try to stick with what our predetermined internship hours spent for the year is, because we tend to go over that. And then ultimately, we're going to develop programs, platforms, and processes to commercialize our new brand positioning. Extremely crucial, right? Because now we did all this work, we have all this wonderful material, we have our brand positioning statement, we have our mission, we have our, but how do we monetize it? How do we make money from it, right? So we're going to talk the talk and we're going to walk the walk. You know, every single day, we're going to deliver the best value to our customer and to our team members. And it's our job as a department to figure out how we're going to do that, right? From at the store level, at the office level, at the communication level, and all that. We're going to unleash the VF Outlet value proposition as the main call to action driver, meaning every communication that we put out there, we got to be speaking to our value proposition. We're going to align all the business areas around the common vision, mission, and values. We're going to identify and put into place processes and pipelines for idea generation and communication. The reality is the best ideas come from the field. They come from many, many places. They don't come from just our department or from our the fifth floor. They can come from all places where VF Outlet operates. So the goal is to put together processes and put into place pipelines and platforms whereby the field or anybody within the company can feel free to share an idea or an opinion or some kind of a feedback as to how we can better generate value every day, every single day, day in and day out.
Just pause there before we move to the next thing. We're going to take a deeper dive into what the whole brand position statement is, but why doesn't everybody just stand up for a minute? All right, stretch your legs. All right. It's been a lot to digest. You know, the reality is this is a year's worth of work that you're hearing about, and it is time consuming, and I think there's a lot of information being shared, and it's probably hard to digest it all. We're going to have the decks to help kind of do some of that, but I think it's important that we take the time to hear what each other's objectives and our processes and our projects are for the year, because you understand the reasons why. You know, I always say the most important thing to being successful is taking the time to not only understand what you're doing or what your other departments are doing, but why are they doing it? And that's the whole purpose of this morning's exercise, is to make sure that everybody in the team not only understands, you know, what they're doing, but what they're doing and how it affects the rest of the departments and what they're doing affects you, right? So I think this is a good thing to do this. I want everybody to stand up and take a break for a second, but we'll sit back down. Michaela's going to take us through the rest of the mission statement process. We're winding down. You're in the last couple minutes, all right? Yeah. But this is really important stuff, and I really appreciate everybody's attention. You've been a great audience listening through this, and then we'll wind down here with this mission statement presentation and we'll go on from there. So it's good to take a break and then sit down.
Yeah, so we're going to wrap it up with the brand positioning statement. And before we do that, I want to talk about...
Oh, good.
So before we unveil what our brand positioning statement is, I think it's important that we understand what is a brand position, right? And the brand positioning is defined as our brand or product is perceived in the mind of a consumer in relation to competitors' brands in the market. So the clearer is your brand positioning statement, the better is going to be the real estate space you occupy in the customer's brains, right? So positioning is the act of placing a company's brand in consumers' minds over and against competitors in terms of brand's characteristics and benefits. So the clearly we can delineate these, the clearly we can make a case for our brand positioning statement, the easier it's going to be perceived by a customer and therefore act upon it. So why is a brand positioning important? A well-prepared brand positioning allows us to differentiate ourselves from the competition while allowing us to communicate with our customer with one voice and one message, something that we haven't been able to do so far. I just wanted to put a little bit of color behind, you know, the process, how we got to this point. These are some of the quotes that were captured from the Empathica feedback, right? And these are our customers commenting in our stores, right? I like shopping here because of the awesome savings on name brand items, Costa Canada. I like the VFL because they carry nice quality products at very affordable prices. We have had great luck there, Story City. I like VFL because the prices are very affordable and they have a variety of clothing for the entire family, from my husband all the way to my grandkids, Nashville. The prices are great. I had to check with the clerk to make sure the low price was correct. Concord. Now, the reason why I put this here is because, you know, it tells us we didn't really have to look very, very far. The answer was right. It has always been there in front of us. The reason why we exist, the reason why we've been successful, the reason why after 40 years we're still standing is because we offer something very, very unique that very, very few other brands can, right? And this is sort of a testament to that. It really speaks to really who we are. The core, the essence of who we are is we offer these really amazing, amazing values, right? And I think it was important for us to kind of share that with you. And I think it's important for us to understand also who our customer is, right? So I wrote this, you know, this note, our customer, lest we forget. But there she is. Every day you walk into our store, into any stores, and you're going to run into her, right? Now, she comes in many shapes, in many forms, in many colors. But it's her, right? That's the customer that we're going to come across in our stores, right? With our family, right? So what is our brand positioning based? Now, and I'm sorry, before we get to the brand positioning, I just wanted to speak about the points that make the brand positioning, right? Which is the target market, the brand promise, and the reason to believe. So the target market really is a way for us to identify who we're going after, right? In our case, it's a budget-conscious, time-challenged moms and families seeking value and quality, right? There's no doubt. It's as clear as day, right? It's a budget-conscious, time-challenged mom and family who's seeking value and quality. Now, what is the brand promise? The brand promise is really what makes it, you know, what are we promising her as a brand, right? Well, our promise is to consistently provide unmatchable value on great quality national brands for the whole family. And the reason to believe, which what it does, it substantiates that promise, which makes it true and livable, is VFO's unique access to the widest assortments and best prices of company-owned, great quality national brands since 1972. That's extremely important. That's your validator. That's what makes your promise true. Because anybody can promise anything. Any brand can promise, no, we have best customer service, the best this, but you have to have a reason to believe to back that. And that's our reason to believe. Our unique access to the widest assortments and best prices of company-owned, great quality national brands since 1972. Extremely, extremely important for us to remember that. So, as we talk about the VFL target, which is a budget-conscious mom who would look at VFL as a one-stop saving solution for the entire family, in this population segment is the most likely to choose us because our strengths match up perfectly with this segment's wants and needs. So that's where the perfect balance is between what the customer wants and what we can offer, what we best offer, right? So if the target needs value, we deliver the best value in the channel. If the target customer seeks quality, we provide great quality of national brands. If they appreciate convenience, we offer one-stop shopping solution. If they respond favorably to variety, we present the widest assortment of denim. If they value acknowledgement, we provide respectful and courteous service. So between this target and us, there is probably the most the best match we can possibly offer. And this is where we're going to win. And that's what we've been able to win so far. So what is our brand positioning statement? So to budget-conscious moms and families seeking value and quality, VF Outlet offers unmatchable value on great quality national brands. VF Outlet does this by having unique access to the widest assortment and best prices of company-owned brands, national brands, since 1972.
Well said.
That's it.
So just pause on that for a second, right? And you're going to be dismissing here in a couple minutes and going back and thinking about your own individual objectives for 2015. And I just want to keep everybody in thought. The two things you've heard the most consistent around our initiatives for 2015 is commercializing our brand position, which is at value, right? It's all about really exploiting and taking full advantage of the value proposition that we inherently create within our organization. No one can dispute the fact that VF Outlet, through our company-owned brands and through the liquidation of distressed goods, creates enormous value opportunities for our organization and for our customers, right? The second thing that you've heard, equally important in today's presentations, is the idea of innovation as a process, right? And remember, what was the definition of innovation? I hinted early on. Does anyone remember? Anything new that creates value, right? So when you leave and think about your individual objectives for 2015, you think about things that you're going to do that are new, that you didn't do last year, right, that are going to create value. And as you do that, remember, innovation is about reducing cost. It's about telling your story more effectively, commercialization of innovation, sustainable innovation, which is that constant improvement, and then the breakthrough innovation, things that are just wildly new that we never thought of before, right, that are truly breakthrough. So you think about those four types of ideas that you're going to build into your initiatives, into your plans, and how they create value, and then how that value fuels our brand promise. And the two are a constant circle, right? It never stops. Because every time we come up with a new idea, we create new value. Every time we make that statement, we promise customers greater value. They don't expect to have the same experience this year they had last year, so they're going to expect newness. So they expect better and better value every day. Therefore, it's up to us to innovate and create new ideas that create value, which feed the engine. It's a wonderful story, and it connects together so nicely that when you leave here and you work on your individual plans, you've got to knit those things together, right? Commit to the idea of creating greater value for our customers every day, and you do that by innovation, right? And then all the other things that happen. There's a lot of work. I mean, let's not kid ourselves. We heard Chris talk about the things that none of us think about in the background, but yet when we took our eye off the ball and we stopped remodeling our fitting rooms, think how terrible our stores got, right? And when we stop doing those block and tackle basic things, a lot of bad things happen. When we stop scanning documents or worrying about record retention, we filled the basement of the Red Building with document storage, right? We filled the industrial park area out on the fifth floor. So you gotta pay attention to all the basic things happening too, that just, you know, get things done, but you also have to think about newness that creates new opportunities to grow, new opportunities to innovate, to reduce costs, to provide the customers a greater value experience, right? And it's really just simple. What does VF Outlet do? We create great value for our consumers. How do we do that? Through innovation, right? And then all the other things that you talked about are outcries of innovation, because they're all new ideas, new ways of doing things, new ways of approaching your work and your day that fuels innovation, which fuels value and creates value, right? That's the process. So today, the whole afternoon is just continuation of what you heard, and you have to personalize it. And that's what we're going to do, right? So Michelle, can I walk us through the rest of the day, please?
Sure. So right now, if you pull out your agenda, it's break time. And so
thank God.
The restrooms are straight across the hall as you exit the theater. There's snacks and beverages out there, so please help yourself. You can also see on your agenda where your room assignment is based on your department. So we'll give you 20 minutes just to breathe a little bit, get a snack, go to the restroom. And then if you can report to your designated room by 10:50, and then you have the rest of the time until lunch with your team. Lunch is at 12:30. Back up in the room where breakfast was served, 2:38. So you can report back up there at 12:30. We'll have lunch. And then the afternoon is really set aside for you to go back and start working to develop your 2015 plan. Please know that we're available. We know this is a new process based on Workday. So please know that we're available. We'll be in the HR department. You can call us. We'll be happy to come over and help you, assist you at your desk if you have questions or concerns. The goal is to really have your plan completed by today, or the majority of it. Stores are not getting the DVDs till tomorrow, won't have store meetings until Friday, so we'll follow up with the stores as to the due dates for your 2015 plans. Any questions? Okay, enjoy the rest of your day. Thanks so much.
Thank you.